Everyone, God bless you. So good to have you join us this morning as we get started for our morning worship service, our time of worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. It has been a wonderful, wonderful week. Thank God. I've been feeling better and better each day, and I'm so grateful for that. I thank the Lord for what he's done, for what he's doing, for what he's going to do. Praise the Lord. We are going to ask that we join together this morning as we go into prayer. I'm going to ask Pastor Blakely if he would lead us in prayer, please.
Father in heaven, we love you and we thank you, O God, for the day, for allowing us to be not only your dear children, but God, to be your servants. God, we ask that as we move forward, Lord, with preparing our hearts and our minds to receive your word, Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would come into the places where we are, each individual place, Lord, each individual heart. Bless, O Lord, lead us and guide us. Father, even take us to farther places, Lord, for your kingdom. Let your plan be revealed. Bless the man of God this morning, O God, that he would have ease of speech, Lord, clarity of thought and mind. Holy Spirit, just give us the instructions and the guidance that you want us to have. And Father, we know that when your word goes out, it never returns void. So Lord, we thank you and we give you the praise and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We're so grateful this morning for all things. I'm going to ask Sister Katie, if you would please read the morning scripture for us.
Good morning. Our morning scripture is from Genesis 28, verses 1 through 5. And I'm going to share the screen so that you can see that. And we're reading from the New English Translation. Genesis 28 and 1. So Isaac called for Jacob and blessed him. Then he commanded him, "You must not marry a Canaanite woman." Verse 2, "Leave immediately for Paddan Aram. Go to the house of Bethuel, your mother's father, and find yourself a wife there among the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother." Verse 3, "May the sovereign God bless you. May he make you fruitful and give you a multitude of descendants. Then you will become a large nation." Verse 4, "May he give you and your descendants the blessing he gave to Abraham, so that you may possess the land God gave to Abraham, the land where you have been living as a temporary resident." And verse 5, "So Isaac sent Jacob to his uncle Laban, his mother Rebekah's brother, in Padan Aram." God bless the reading of his word. Pastor?
Thank you so very much. God bless you. Praise the Lord. We're so grateful for his word. And hallelujah, we're excited about what God is doing and what he's going to do and what he's done already. Praise the Lord. This week we started our annual first fruits for the new year. This year we were delayed because of deaths and things that were beyond our control. But God has indeed been with us as we've been studying his word with the topic Baal Perazim. Praise the Lord, the God of the breakthrough. And I'm so grateful for that. Each night has been wonderful, and I appreciate all of those who've been joining along with us, and thank God for his mighty acts on the children of men. Praise the Lord. I also want to thank the Lord and thank Pastor Blakely for filling in for me for the past few weeks when I was gone to Florida for my brother's funeral, my oldest brother, and when I got back, I was just out of it. I didn't have the strength to come on, and I called him at the last minute, and he was so gracious as to fill in for me last week, and I'm so grateful for that. Thank you so much, Pastor Blakely, and thank all of you, praise the Lord, for your prayers. We did feel your prayers while we were away for the funeral. And I want to say that both my wife and I tested positive for COVID, and it's kind of taken its toll on us. As people say, some folks have I've been listening to people since the pandemic, those who had contracted that I was in contact with. One of my good friends in New York had it when it first started last year in New York. And he was saying months and months and months later how he was still trying to get back his stamina, get his strength, because it affected him in that way. And I find it the same thing. It's very exacting up on my energy, but I'm so grateful that God is restoring, because he is a God of restoration. Praise the Lord. The Lord love you, and I love you too. Praise God. And so this morning, I'm going to, by God's grace, share with you what God has given me for today. As I have been finding, the Lord had spoken to me about this in years past. I just didn't know at that time it was for this time. Praise the Lord. And so I'm so grateful for that. I just praise the Lord that he's done that. Hallelujah. And he's doing great things. Praise the Lord. And I'm so grateful for it. So this morning, we are going to look at the Baal Perazim from the perspective that God who breaks through, God's liberating, God breakthrough liberating truth. Praise the Lord. That's what I've titled today's message, God liberating breakthrough truth, or God's breakthrough liberating truth. God's breakthrough liberating truth. Praise the Lord. So we've already read the passage, but we're just going to look at it once more. We got the time. It's only five verses. So we go to our right to Genesis 28, 1 through 5. And I read the New English Translation 2 years ago, praise the Lord. And that's when I received it. So I checked it with what I'm reading this year from New Living Translation, and that's not very much at all changes or difference. And so I just stuck with it. Verse 1, so Isaac called for Jacob and blessed him. Then he commanded him, "You must not marry a Canaanite woman." Praise the Lord. Verse 2, leave immediately for Padan Aram and go to the house of Bethuel, praise the Lord, your mother's father, and find yourself a wife there among the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. Verse 3, may the sovereign God bless you. Now, please pay close attention to this. May the sovereign God bless you. May he make you fruitful and give you a multitude of descendants. Then you will become a large nation. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 4, may he give you and your descendants the blessing he gave to Abraham, so that you may possess the land God gave to Abraham, the land where you have been living as a temporary resident. Praise the Lord. And finally, so Isaac sent Jacob to his uncle, Laban, his mother, Rebekah's brother, in Padan Aram. Praise the Lord. Now, it's quite interesting because God got a wife for Isaac. Abraham's servant went to the same place. And he got a wife for Isaac from that same, doing the same process, praise the Lord. And so now Isaac is doing differently, just slightly, because Abraham sent his servant and brought Rebekah, his wife, back from Laban to Isaac in Canaan. But now Isaac is sending his son there himself to get a wife, praise the Lord. And that's quite interesting. There's a great story behind that, but I'm not going to take the time to go into that story. I'm just going to move on with the message as the Lord has given it to me. Praise the Lord. So Isaac called for Jacob and blessed him. Now, the beginning sentence in this chapter is actually the culmination of the narrative that began in chapter 27 of Genesis. Specifically verses 28 and 29, which we will visit actually later. But as Isaac sent Jacob to his uncle back in the old country to find a wife, as I said earlier, the exact process that Abraham followed for Isaac's wife. So we know that Isaac is going there. I'm sorry, Jacob is going on a mission. His mission is to get a wife, but he's always also running from something. He's running from his brother Esau, because as we know, there was an incident where Jacob deceived Esau. Deceived his brother Esau, and had his father bless him with the blessing that is normally reserved for the firstborn. Isaac was the firstborn, but God blessed Jacob with the Abraham covenant, and we're going to see that as we move on. The reason I say that is it is going to become clear as we move on. So verses 3 and 4 is the Abrahamic blessing that God sovereignly ordained for Jacob. Now, wait, Pastor, you just said that the blessing, the Abrahamic blessing order is normally, or the blessing that of the firstborn is normally reserved for the firstborn, who was Esau. But through some deception, praise the Lord, Jacob deceived his father Isaac, who was blind for the most part at this time, and he got that blessing laid upon him. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. As we move along, we're going to see that God has a plan and a purpose for our lives, and there is absolutely nothing that the enemy can do to prevent that from happening. I need y'all to understand this. We're dealing with God. We're not dealing with man. We're not dealing with innuendos or nuances or anything mystical or mystic. This is God. And everything is open with him with whom we have to do. It's wide open. All you have to do is read the scripture. And I promise you, when you read the scripture, and the Bible says, if you want to know him, you must go on to know him. And if you seek him, you will be found of him. If you seek him with your whole heart, praise the Lord. And I know I'm seeking God with my whole heart, because I want to know God. And y'all know my testimony. Not only do I want to know God and the power of his resurrection, but I am confident and I'm convicted and convinced that I want to know him also in the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable to his death. Praise the Lord. Woo, bless his name forever. I just get chills, as they say, when I think about, hallelujah, what it means when you really have resolved to accept whatever God sends your way, and you are not in the business of trying to change God's plans for your life. Praise the Lord. Don't want to take too much time, but we saw that with Hezekiah. The Bible says that Hezekiah was told, set your house in order because you're going to die. And the scripture says that Hezekiah wept and he started crying. And before the Lord, praise the Lord. He never asked it. But every time I read the scripture, I've never seen where Hezekiah asked for some more time. He just said, Lord, you know I've been faithful to you. But God knew his heart. He knew he didn't want to die. He wanted to live on. Praise the Lord. So God sent the servant back and told him, I'm going to add 15 more years to your life. But if you read the last 15 years of Hezekiah's life, he backslid. He messed up. Praise our God. Had he died when God told him he was going to die? Praise the Lord. And God didn't even tell him when he was going to die. He just said, set your house in order because you're surely going to die. But he didn't give him a time. He just told him. But Hezekiah jumped the gun. Praise the Lord. And so he wasn't satisfied with the message he received from God. And so he sought to change it. And God heard his cry and just sent the message back and said, I've added 15 more years to your life. But as I said, they were not good years. So I want to just say today that God has a plan for our lives. And there's nothing anyone can do to prevent what God's going to do for you, praise the Lord, unless you disagree with God. I hope and pray that you don't disagree with God, that you learn to say, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. Yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you. I will trust you and obey. Praise the Lord. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart, I will agree. And my answer always to whatever you say is yes, Lord, yes. Praise the Lord. So, as I said, verses 3 and 4 is the Abrahamic blessing that God sovereignly ordained for Jacob. May the sovereign God bless you. May he make you fruitful and give you you a multitude of descendants. Then you will become a large nation. May he give you and your descendants the blessing he gave to Abraham, so that you may possess the land God gave to Abraham, the land where you have been living as a temporary resident. Praise the Lord. You've been living here temporarily. Where you're living, hallelujah, your status is temporary. You don't really own it yet. You don't really own it. I've given it to you, but you don't own it yet. It's not clear and free and clear. I haven't set that up yet. I haven't set it for you. Praise the Lord. There's many times in our lives that God has done things in our life, and it's already ours, but you're not ready to receive it. Praise God. And if you read on, I think it's the 15th chapter of Genesis. Praise the Lord. God told Abraham, he says, I'm going to give it to you. But the sin of these people, the Amorites and all these other folk, their sin, the time for them to sin has not been fulfilled. They were going to, God was going to give them over 430 years, because Israel was down in Egypt for 430 years. So just think about it. Those people had over 430 years to get it right with God, but they didn't. And so God said, okay, when it's time for Israel to come back. And he told them, Abraham, your descendants are going to sojourn to a land. They're going to be there for 430 years, but then they're going to come back. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Woo, bless his name. Hallelujah. How many would change their minds and change their ways if they knew exactly how long they had to change? But we don't know that. So we have to live constantly in a constant state of readiness. When Jesus calls us, we'll be ready to go. It's an old song that we used to sing years ago. I know probably a lot of people don't know. When he calls me, I will answer. When he calls me, I will answer. When he calls me, I will answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. So we move on, and then we was coming to some of the heart of the matter here. Many believers struggle with understanding the biblical figure of Jacob when they consider his life, at least privately. You know, people don't always say it, but they think about it. Their basic question may be expressed as, how could a thief, a liar, and a coward be considered the father of God's people, Israel? How could that happen? Praise God. Hallelujah. Listen, many people have questions about you and your calling and God's ministry in your life. How could you or God use you to do what he wants you to do? Now, Jacob was a thief. He was a liar, and he was a coward, hallelujah, because he was running away from Esau, even though he was the initiative that Rebekah initiated this getting away with, because she heard that Esau wanted to kill Jacob after he heard that Jacob had deceived his father and took the blessing, if you will, or stole the blessing, as some people call it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That was meant for him. And so he wanted to kill him. And so Rebecca said, get him out of here. And she used the guy and says, I don't want him to marry any of these Canaanite women. Send him away to my brother so he can get a husband. Praise the Lord. So Jacob was not the only one. David, the scripture says, God said, David is a man after my own heart. Praise the Lord. In other words, he was saying Saul was chosen because people wanted him. They looked down him on his outward appearance. And so God said, okay, that's what you want him. You can have him. So he chose Saul. But God said, I choose David. He's the man after my own heart. Praise the Lord. He's the one I want to rule. And so God chose him. And listen, don't forget this, that God is omniscient. He knows everything. God is omnipresent. He's always present at all times. So he knew exactly what David was going to do. Scripture says he's Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the initiator. He's the author and the finisher of your faith. Not only is he author and finisher of your faith, he's the author and finisher of your life. He started your life. He gave you life from the beginning. He also knows what your expiration date is. Praise the Lord. Some people say humans don't have expiration dates. I beg to differ. Yes, you do. The scripture said every man is born to die. You got an expiration date. Praise the Lord. So David was a liar. David was a murderer. David was an adulterer. Praise God. So God's people, hallelujah, are not exempt from all of the curses of the flesh. Hallelujah. But God still chooses whom he wants to use. Praise the Lord. But the wonderful thing about God is he knows how to prepare us. He knows how to fix us. And he does that through his son, Jesus Christ. All we need to do is accept his plan, his propitiation for our sin. The death of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus saves us because we trust in his plan for our salvation, who is the Lord Jesus Christ. He can change us and we can be changed. We don't have to stay the same. Praise the Lord. Bless his name forever. And so this first observation that I want to share with you as we come to this point is the same can be said of many, if not all of us, whom God has sovereignly chosen for his purpose and plan. We're just like Jacob. We're just like David. We're just like Abraham. Hallelujah. All of us are the same. The same can be said of many, if not all of us, whom God has, don't forget this, whom God has sovereignly chosen for his purpose and plan. Sovereignly means that God can do what he wants, when he wants, how he wants, and there's not anyone that can question him, and he doesn't have to explain why he does what he does. Praise the Lord. And so he sovereignly chose you, knowing who you are, knowing what you think, knowing what you're going to do tomorrow, knowing what you're thinking right now. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God knows you completely, in and out, through and through. There's nothing that you can hide from him. And so as I come to this story and the questions that surrounds this story that seem to want to question or impugn God for allowing Jacob to be who he has chosen and have done what he's done. And so I researched and I found this. I want to share a commentary from the Jewish perspective under the title, How Can a Blessing, listen to this carefully, How Can a Blessing Be Stolen? How can a blessing be stolen? That's the question. And here's the statement. What God ordained is what happens. Our sovereign God, what he ordained is what happens. The commentator writes, I believe that the blind, elderly Isaac, had two different blessings in store for his sons. One was the blessing of the firstborn son prepared for Esau. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the other was the blessing of Abraham prepared for Jacob. That's a different perspective. The first was a general blessing of prosperity and power. But the second one had to do with the special calling of Abraham. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And if you read those, the 27, 28, if you read those chapters carefully, you'll see that this is true. Hallelujah. Now, keep in mind, what God ordained is what happens, no matter what it looks like. What God ordains is what happens. Now, From this perspective, Jacob's place in the covenant was not based on his deception and tricking his father into thinking he was Esau. In fact, upon his return from Haran, Jacob sent reparations to Esau before meeting him. And in doing so, he honestly acknowledged the sin of his youth and returned that which he had stolen. Genesis chapter 32, verse 13, it says, Jacob selected these gifts from his possessions. Hallelujah. To present to his brother Esau. Verse 14. 200 female, praise the Lord. 200, let me change this view here. Thank you. 200 female goats, 20 male goats, 200 ewes, 20 rams, 13 female camels with their young, 40 cows, 10 bulls, 20 female donkeys, and 10 male donkeys. That's the stuff that Jacob sent to Esau just before he got back to where he was. Praise the Lord. Now, the Bible says that he was afraid, and that's why he did what he did. He was afraid of his brother. So he sent this stuff, praise the Lord, to him. In fact, the scripture teaches us that the night before Esau, before he met Esau, Jacob's encounter with the angel of the Lord enabled him to overcome his fears. Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 through 30. I'm not going to read it all, but you can read it. He was there with the angel. Y'all remember the story. He was there with a man, and he met this man, praise our God, and this angel of the Lord. It helped him to be able to meet with his brother because he really was afraid. And you all remember last week when I was talking about when you're afraid, you should admit that you're afraid. Don't try to pretend to God that you're not afraid. You are afraid. God is able to answer your prayer, and he's able to meet you right where you are. Now, in the end, the brothers, both of them, their lives may have followed the plan of their originally intended blessing. Now, that's what the commentator writes. But I say, yes, it did. In the end, the brothers followed the plan of their originally intended blessings. What God ordains, hallelujah, what God ordains happens. Esau did acquire profit, prosperity, and power. Genesis 27, 28, 29. From the dew of heaven and the riches of the earth, may God always give you abundant harvest of grain and bountiful new wine. May many nations become your servants, and may they bow down to you. May you be the master over your brothers, and may your mother's sons bow down to you. All who curses you will be cursed, and all who bless you will be blessed. But Jacob gained the blessing of Abraham, a heritage of children and land. That's in Genesis 28, 1 and 5. We read that already. There was a difference between just the regular posterity blessing, the regular blessing of the firstborn, and that of the Abrahamic blessing. And so that's where the confusion comes in with people. Sometimes they think that from the outset, from the appearance of it, Jacob deceived him and he stole the blessing, but he didn't. And there's more proof of that as we move on. How could a blessing be stolen? Now, you need to think about this, because remember, I keep saying this now. I've been saying this for a long time. I want folk to know God, not stuff, not things, not ideas, not teachings, but get to know God. And the way you get to know God is, according to the scripture, is surrender your heart to him, ask him to come into your life, let him save you. Praise God, and you're born again. And now once you're born again, you start to grow in God. You grow, praise the Lord. You go on to know him, praise the Lord. You get to know God through your experience with him. Hallelujah. I think it's in Hebrews, he says, we do the things that's right because we've gotten used to it. We made ourselves used to doing what's right. We practice what's right. I think it's the fourth chapter of Hebrews. You can check it and read it, either fourth or the sixth, can't remember exactly right now, but it says that we do right just because we practice it. We learn how to do it. We practice every day. You know, it's not something that comes overnight. In the Sunday school lesson this morning, talked about emotions and how we react to certain stimuli to our emotions. And to a person, everyone admitted, yes, the truth is, yeah, when there's some emotional trauma that happens or something stimulates my emotion, like, you know, maybe somebody cuts you out or someone cuts you off, or maybe something happens between spouses and words are said and things get out of hand and praise the Lord. And instead of speaking with grace and having our words seasoned with salt, praise the Lord, they're seasoned with pepper, praise the Lord. So that's what can happen, praise the Lord. So we can think things like this. We can in our emotions, when we read the scriptures, we can see, well, how did that happen? You know, he was a thief and Jacob was a supplanter and all. And we have all of these words that we can describe people. And so that's what Jacob was. And he was a thief. He was a deceiver, praise the Lord. But God was going to deal with that, just like he's going to deal with all those things in our lives. God deals with all that stuff. Hallelujah. But he still plans to use you. He still called you. So think about it. How could a blessing stolen from his dispossessed brother, Esau, establish Jacob's legitimacy as the patriarch of God's people? It could never happen. That would never happen. It has not happened. It never will. Nobody can steal what God has planned for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. No one, because God is sovereign. The answer is that it did not. Jacob's actions did not set him up to be the patriarch of God's people. The blessing of Abraham was always intended to pass to Jacob. Read Genesis 25 and 23. It's the story, and it's just one verse. I didn't put the whole verse down because I don't want to read the whole story, but just this one verse, and I'll give you the background. And the scripture says, and the Lord told her, Rebecca, that's Jacob and Esau's mom, the sons in your womb will become two nations. From the very beginning, the two nations will be rivals. One nation will be stronger than the other. And your brother, your older son, Esau, will serve your younger son, Jacob. Praise the Lord. Rebecca knew that already because God had told her. But somehow or another, this is like I was speaking last week, we sometimes resign ourselves to God's will rather than accept it. Resignation and acceptance is two different things. You just say, well, Lord, I don't like it, but that's the way you want to do it. You know, I just have to go along with it. But, you know, and in the back of our minds, I've even said it, Lord, I wouldn't do it that way. But, you do it the way you want to do it. But I'm being honest, Lord, I do it a different way. I know I'm not the only one who said it. If you haven't said it, you thought it. God wants to do it one way and you want to do it another. Rebecca knew that. She knew what God had told her. When the children were in their womb, their destiny had already been ordained. Hear me again. While the two boys, Jacob and Esau, was in the mother's womb, their destiny had already been ordained. And what God ordains will happen. Hallelujah. Don't get caught on how it happened. know that it happened, because if you get caught up on how it happened, you'll start being self-righteous and full of pride and trying to say that was sin, that was sin, and pointing out sin. Leave it alone. Hallelujah. It's not the first time that something like this happened in the scripture, and it surely wasn't the last. The difficulty of understanding how this could be God's perfect divine will is due to the human's inability to know the mind of God. That's why it's so hard for us to be able to wrap our minds around certain things, because we can't understand the mind of God. It is difficult for us to see beyond the deceptive actions and deeds associated with the pronouncing and transference of the blessing that misguided our perspective and conclusion. Observation number two. It is good for us to remember that God is sovereign and what that means. You remember what the Lord says, as recorded in Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 through 11. Verse 8, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine." Number 9, "For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts." Verse 10, "The rain and snow come down from the heavens and stay on the ground to water the earth. They cause the grain to grow, producing seed for the farmer and bread for the hungry." Verse 11, "It is the same with my word. I send it out, and it always produces fruit. It will accomplish all I want it to, and it will prosper everywhere I send it." Praise the Lord. Isn't that beautiful? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. What God ordains is what happens. Just because we don't see it doesn't mean that it's not God ordained. The observation number three, the hows, whys, and wherefores of our sovereign Father. Our sovereign Father God are always beyond the scope of our ability to understand or reason. I'll read it again. The hows, the whys, and the wherefores of our sovereign Father God are always beyond the scope of our ability to understand or reason. You can't do it. You won't be able to understand it. Ooh, bless his name forever. Hallelujah. It saddens me sometimes when I hear different people say certain things. Like someone had a question for me. Brother Clovis, Pastor Wilson, when I pray, should I pray in tongues, or should I pray soft? Because if I pray loud, the devil may hear what I'm saying, and I may not get it. Praise the Lord. How can the enemy, the devil, prevent God's sovereign blessing plan for your life? Can't happen. Can't happen. And personal testimony. The Lord told me that he was going to give us this building project, and he was going to do it for us. And my inclination would be to, okay, thank you, Lord, and just share that information with the saints. Now, maybe not even all of them, because I had heard that too years ago. You know, don't let your right hand know what your left hand is doing, you know, and applying that in what God says. So the Lord began to speak to me. Who are you serving? If I said it, you say it. Praise the Lord. And I said, okay, Lord, I'm so sorry. And I realized then that you're saying what God is going to do cannot be thwarted by anything that the enemy wants to do. As you remember in the Bible class last week, I'm not worried about what goes on in the enemy's camp. If God wants me to know, he'll let me know. I gave you the passage of scripture where you can see that. Unfortunately, I didn't think to put it here because I didn't think about it. I don't always have remember the references, but I know it's there. You do too, because I gave it to you Friday or Thursday or Friday night. I can't remember which night. The scripture says that the king thought that someone was spying, and one of his men was spying and telling Israel everything that was happening, and so preventing them from being able to overcome Israel. But one of the men in his own, one of his own men says, "No, sir, king, it's not that. There's a man in Israel, a prophet in Israel, who tells the king what you do, what you're saying in your bedroom and when your bedchambers." Praise God. So God, and we don't have to worry about what's going on in the enemy. And we saw that also with Jonathan, I believe it was. Jonathan, when Jonathan and Saul and the crew was out fighting the enemy, God told him that you're going to get the victory. And Jonathan and his armor bearer went up and they overheard a conversation from the enemy's camp. Saying, "I had a dream last night, and I saw this big bagel, they came rolling down into camp and just smashed all of our tents and destroyed us completely." And the other enemy, a soldier that was listening to him, "That's nobody but Gideon." That was Gideon, I think it was. Gideon and his group. And they were coming to destroy us. And the scripture says from that point on, they all just ran away and left. The scripture that teaches us that the God we serve is not only omniscient, he's omnipotent, he's all power. He's awesome in his power. Praise the Lord. And the enemy ran away and they didn't even have to fight. All they had to do was go into the enemy's camp and take what they had left. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So we move on. We must therefore then, so since we know that this can't happen, that the hows, the whys, and wherefores of our sovereign Father God are always beyond the scope of our ability to understand or reason, we therefore must humbly yield and bow in humble submission to the most liberating words Jesus taught us by example to pray when he said, "Lord, not my will, but your will. Oh, gracious Father, be done." That's what we pray all the time. No matter what it is, we don't know what the wherefores or whys, and we can't understand what's going on or reason it. We just have to yield and say, "Lord, your will be done." Hallelujah. So I just want to give the Lord thanks. Father, thank you for this Baal Perazim. This Perazim, thank you for your graciousness in revealing this awesome, enlightening breakthrough truth. Indeed, how can anyone, a supernatural being, the devil, or much less a mere human, steal a divinely ordained, divinely purposed, divinely planned, and sovereignly executed blessing? Bless his name forever. The blessing did not come from Jacob. Jacob pronounced the blessing, but the blessing was God's blessing. It was God's plan. And there's no one, not even our own selves included. Thank you, Jesus. Prevent God's plan from happening in our lives. Aren't you glad about that? Hallelujah. If that was the truth, many of us wouldn't even be here this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. I know I wouldn't. Thank you, Jesus. God gave me a blessing plan and gave me a plan and set me on the way. And hallelujah. And sometimes I myself was trying my best to sabotage God's plan for my life. But he wouldn't even allow me to sabotage his ordained, divine, executed blessing on my life. I'm convinced, Lord, by your word that you are who you say you are. Not only a God of the universe, you are the God of the individual. You are so great, Father, and I'm so small. Yet you always hear each time I call. Though I'm unworthy of your love and care, you pour unnumbered blessings on me from your heavenly throne, says a beautiful hymn that I know. So we get to observation number four, the final observation. Thank you, God, because my actions, good or bad, does not alter or prevent your divinely ordained plan. Thank you, Jesus. My actions, my words, my thoughts does not alter or prevent God's divinely ordained plan. And when I say that, sometimes it's very difficult for us to understand that because we are looking at situations and circumstances that are actual facts. I mean, who can dispute what the word of God says when we read that Jacob went in before his father and said, and lied and said, bless me, father. Who is this? I'm Esau, your son. You can't deny that didn't happen. That happened. Praise God. But that has nothing to do. Hallelujah. And I say that and in reality, praise our God. Hallelujah. God uses that to get Jacob to a place where now he can deal with him. And if you keep reading the story in Jacob's life, you'll see that God met him on the way to Padan Aram. And Jacob at that point made a deal, if you will, with God. He made a covenant with God. He said, God, if you go with me and bring me back safe, help me to accomplish what I need to accomplish. He says, you be my God and I'll serve you. And he went on his way, praise our God, and God heard his prayer because it was in his will that he do what he was doing. Thank you, Jesus. So God used it. God used it, y'all hear me. God used what the enemy meant for evil, for his good. And that's what happened to Joseph. What his brothers meant for evil, God meant it for good. It did not excuse his brothers because Joseph told him, see, y'all meant to harm me. But don't be afraid. Woo-hoo. Hallelujah. Don't be afraid. I'm not, that was God's, that's God's business. I'm not getting into that. All I'm telling you all is this. God meant it for good. And that's who we have to deal with. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. When we get to that point in life, man, oh man, you're walking with the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so today we want to pray, Lord, please accept my humble apology. Please accept our humble apology and confession for all that I do, all that we do or think that does not bring honor to you. Sometimes in our way of thinking, when we are looking at a perspective that's completely not God's way of thinking, it doesn't bring honor to God. Praise the Lord. In the Sunday school this morning, again, it was the same thing. What the children of Israel was doing against poor Moses, 38 years after they left the promised land, and I marked it and I made note of it as I read through it each year. This was now the 10th time. That was the 10th time that they had complained against Moses. And boy, was he upset. Praise God. And his emotions got the best of him. But praise the Lord for Jesus, because God, hallelujah, looked beyond his fault and saw his need. And even though he didn't go into the promised land on earth, man, if you would ask Moses after he went up on the mountain, actually on top of Mount Pisgah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And God says, come, I'm going to show you, but you're not going to go. And God showed him that, and he told him, he says, man, he says, everything that's happened is going to change. It's kind of like with Hezekiah. Praise our God. They changed once they got over there. But then somehow or another, I don't know, I believe that God gave him a glimpse into heaven. And someone asked me one time, wasn't that cruel of God to let Moses go through all of that, still miss the reward of getting into the promised land? I said, man, you just need to understand where Moses went. And if someone had asked him, do you want to go over there? I'm sure that Moses would not have agreed to go to the, absolutely not. I'm going with God. And the scripture tells us that that God buried him there. And no one has ever found the body of Moses yet. And the scripture says, and I think it's, can't remember, again, he says, even when, and I think it was Paul saying this, even when Moses was contending even when Satan was contending for the body of Moses, the angel didn't even bring in the railing accusations against him. All he did was say simply, the Lord rebuke you. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. So as we conclude, let's all praise to the Lord and ask him, Lord, help me to live out the desire of my heart, which is to please you in all I am and in all I do. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. What a wonderful liberating truth that is to know, hallelujah, that God has a plan for your life, and what God has ordained for your life is what's going to happen, regardless of all of life's circumstances. God's plan for your life is what's going to happen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. You can unmute yourself and just worship and praise the Lord for a few seconds, if you will, please. Just, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for this liberating truth. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That's what Jesus did. Hallelujah. He gave us liberating truth.
Hallelujah.
He sat down after he had read from the book and he says, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Yeah. He has sent me to relieve the oppressed. He has sent me to set at liberty them that are bound, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Hallelujah. This is a liberating truth of God.
Lord, I thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Yes,
nothing the enemy can do, hallelujah, to prevent God's ordained plan for your life. God's divine plan for your life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It sets you free. It sets you free to worship God. It sets you free to seek for God, hallelujah, without fear. Hallelujah, without judgment. Praise God, God. Hallelujah. God has set us free. We are free. Free, God, from all of the accusations of Satan. Oh, bless his name. He's an accuser of the brethren, but God has set us free from all of them. No matter what he said, God's word. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
I praise you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Well, God bless you, and thank you for joining us this morning. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask Pastor Blakely, if he would please, to give us any announcements. Praise the Lord. And also to thank you also. I thank you so much for your continued support, and he's going to expand on that. Praise the Lord. Thank you for what you've been doing, for your support for prayers. We're praying for all of those that are on our sick list. Praise God as he dismissed. Praise the Lord. We're praying for all those who are sick in the hospital and those who have the bereaved families all over. Praise Jesus. God bless you, Pastor. Thank you so much.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for the word today and for how God is using not only our leader, but using his word to continue to encourage us and strengthen us to move forward with his plan. Just remember that you can still give through Cash App, and the Cash App address, I believe Sister Katie's gonna put up on the screen in just a moment. But you can also give through Givelify if you are still using Givelify, praise God. As we move forward with the vision, I'm just gonna share with you that if you have not completed your pledge, please start to share your pledge and through your giving and your tithe and your offering. We know that God's got all the cattle on all the hills everywhere. And I know I'm not quoting the scripture as it should be, but as it just comes to my heart, in other words, as Pastor would say, the Lord is in control. The Lord is in control. So we're asking for you to go ahead and give. And then we can get the pledge. And we are looking to prayerfully break ground this year. I hope you're hearing that. We're looking to prayerfully break ground this year. But it does come through your tithe, your offering, your pledge, your giving. That's right. We need your prayer. We do. But we need your tithe. We need your offering. And we need your giving. God bless you. So don't forget that on this coming week, we are still in our consecration month. Praise the Lord. Pastor will be teaching tomorrow night, Monday through Friday. We have prayer from 6 to 6:30. And then at 6:30, Pastor starts the Bible study, the consecration month Bible study. This is a revelation word. I would share with you that if you missed last week, Sister Katie has been diligent to put that up on the Mount Pisgah website. So you can go to the Mount Pisgah website and pull down the notes from last week and get caught up as we move forward. If you felt like you missed something or you just want to look at something again, praise the Lord. So we thank the Lord for that action by Sister Katie. Thank you so much. We will be in our consecration prayer every night, Monday through Friday, 6 p.m. We're coming through Zoom. You can dial into Zoom just like you did for the service. And then 6:30, the pastor continues with the Bible study. So we truly have been having a good time in the Lord. All those that are on the line today, I thank God for you. And we truly and humbly praise the Lord for your attendance. We are moving forward just to give you kind of a update on the building and the actions that are taking place for us to get back into meeting. But if you want to just clap your hands and tell Jesus thank you, if you look at how this has all worked out, even though we went through this circumstance at Mount Pisgah, the Lord has even orchestrated it in society, in the area that we live in, that it was pretty good for us to just go ahead and step back from meeting together for a while. So God has orchestrated everything, and we look forward and praise him for how he's doing things. Amen. Amen. Don't forget, we do have Sunday school. Praise the Lord. I thank the Lord for everybody who attended Sunday school this morning. I hope you had a good time on Sunday school. Sunday school is every Sunday. We're still using Zoom at 9:30. Sunday school at 9:30. And we got done just under an hour today. So it was pretty good. I hope that I know the lesson was good. I don't know about the teacher, but anyway, we praise God. So the word went out. Amen. And we have a dynamic cadre of Sunday school teachers, plural. It's not just one teacher teaching every Sunday. We have different teachers. And so they are preparing. They are getting themselves ready to share the word of God with you and to also address questions and answer. What a better time to just spend time in the Lord and ask questions. Amen. So join us for Sunday school every Sunday at 9:30 via Zoom until we meet back at the church. And then when we meet back at the church, we will meet at the church at 9:30. Praise God. All right. I don't know anything else, Pastor, that if I missed something, you can let me know. But other than that, all right. Praise God. We got everything. So we'll move forward. And as we have been dismissing, we will pray a prayer of benediction, and then we will all come together and say our benediction scripture. So if you'll bow with me where you are. Yes. Father in heaven, we love you and we thank you again, God, for your word that has just not only enlightened us, but Lord, it has strengthened us to know, Lord, that you are God and your plan is sovereign. Yes. No man knows your mind. No man can change your mind. Hallelujah. Only you can decide to change your mind. We can bring our requests to you, Lord. We can even bring our concerns to you. But Lord, whatever you say, that's what we're going to follow. So we love you. As the words of the song say, where you lead me, I will follow. Where you lead me, I will follow. I'll go with you all the way.
Yes,
we will go with you, oh God. And we love you. Thank you for our leadership. Thank you for the diligence that you've given, oh God, our pastor to be there for us, hallelujah, to receive your instructions and share them with us. I thank you for Mother Angie, oh God, and giving her the strength, Lord, and not only recovering this past couple of weeks, but God giving her the strength, period, to endure all these years with all the different ones. Hallelujah. Thank you for Mother Davidson, her absence, oh God. I pray for her, Lord, strength. I pray for her prayers, oh God, that she has set before you, that you would, Lord, let her see the answers.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
Let her see the answers in this lifetime. And Father, as we move forward, we forever give you the praise and the glory and honor in the name of Jesus. And we all say again, as we take ourselves off of mute, give you a second, hit that unmute button. Praise God. Let the words of our mouth,
let the words of our mouth,
and the meditations of my heart,
and the meditations of my heart,
be acceptable to you,
be acceptable to
in your sight, O Lord,
my
strength,
my strength, and my redeemer. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you on the line tomorrow night. God bless you. Love you. Hallelujah.
Love you guys.
Love you. Bless you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.